Hi to everybody. In this course, Classical Mechanics, we are going to start with chapter 1 of your prescribed textbook, and we are actually going to be focusing on the matrix vectors and vector calculus in this chapter. And however, I must also state that I'm not going to go in details, but I will, however, be selective in terms of doing only things that will help you to understand the things that we are going to be doing in this course. Now, the specific goals of this chapter, number one is to understand the relevance of classical mechanics, and number two, you know the concept of scalar and vectors, and you must also be able to derive the equation of the coordinate transformation, and you must also be able to understand the concepts of derivatives, for an example velocity and acceleration, and you must also know the angular velocity, and you must also understand the gradient operator and integration of vectors. And of course, you are also being expected to be able to solve the problems on the above. Now let me introduce you to the why or when the classical mechanics is relevant. For an example, for the object moving at a very low speed, for an example, the movement of a tennis ball from point A to B, or the movement of the velocity of the speed at which the cyclists are moving, movement of cars, then we have to apply the classical mechanics. Now, however, if the speed is very close to the speed of light, or is comparable to the speed of light, therefore we have to use the relativistic mechanics rules. And in terms of the size, classical mechanics is also being used in for macroscopic objects. For an example, the movement of a satellite around the Earth, as we can see the image next to my image there. Therefore, the classical mechanics can be used. The rules of classical mechanics are used. And when we talk about the atomic scale or the scale of H bar, for an example, the movement of electrons around the nucleus, therefore we need to do the quantum mechanics rules. Now there's also this quantum field theory in physics, which is actually combination of all the three, and it is actually used in the particle physics. All right, now let's start with the concept of a scalar. Now consider the array of particles shown in figure A. Say each particles of an array is labeled according to its mass, and it is labeled according to its max in terms of the x and y coordinates. For an example, the mass of a particle when x is equal to 2 and y is equal to 3 would just be 4 grams. Now suppose that we rotate this array, and such that we are going to have the following. And I must also mention that the rotated Cartesian array will have different axes, and the y becomes y prime, and the x becomes the x prime, and the z also becomes the z prime. So for the rotated system, and then this is for the original system or the original Cartesian coordinate, which was not rotated. So that's what you are going to have, and as a result, this is what I am trying to also show you there. However, in this case, the mass of that particular particle is still 4, but the coordinate system for x is just 4, and then for y is 3.5. So in that case, we can just see that the mass of that particular particle is not changing, but what is changing is the coordinate system in terms of the rotation. Right, now the quantities that are invariant under the coordinate transformation, those obeys and equations of this type are termed the scalars. For an example, mass, temperature, and etc. However, other description of some physical properties associated with particles, such as the direction and motion of direction of a force or acceleration, then we have to use the vectors. Now let us also talk about the coordinate transformation. Now consider a point P in the x1 and x2 plane, x1 and x2 plane. Now this point is at x1 in x1 axis, and it is at x2. Now that the coordinate system be rotated so that we can have the x prime 1 and the x prime 2. Now that point P is no longer in a rotated system, is just going to be at x prime 1 and x prime 2. Right, now let us just try to calculate what is the x prime 1. The x prime 1 now is located at the OC from here to there. It's OC, which is nothing else but it's OA plus AC, and AC is just AB plus BC. Right, in that case, we know what is OA. The OA, it can be calculated from this rectangle, and then OA is just x1, the cosine of theta, and then that must be plus, and AC, it can be shown that AC is nothing else but AC is what we call as dx2, this side dx2, it can also be shown. Why are we doing that? Because we want to determine this point in terms of the x1 and in terms of the original x2, so that we can be able to know where is that x prime 1. Now in that case, the dx2 can be calculated from this triangle, and it is actually given as x2 sine of theta. But what is an angle between the sine theta can actually be written with respect to x2. It can be written in terms of the cosine of 90 degrees minus theta. So that is this angle here. Now let us also do the x prime 2. The x prime 2 is just going to be given by, because that is the projection from that point P, is actually the DO minus DE. DO minus DE, but the DE can also be shown to be equals to OF. It can also be equals to OF. Now, what we know is the OF can be calculated from this right angle triangle, and it is actually given as minus OF is x1 sine of theta, but the OD plus OD is just the x2 cosine of theta. Now, we want to write this, all of this thing, in terms of the cosine, not the sines. Now this x1 sine theta can just be given as the, because this is x prime 2 and x1, that is this angle here, the angle between x1 and x prime 2 is just the 90 plus theta. Therefore this is what you are going to have. And of course this is possible because we can see that if this angle here is theta, the angle here is theta, and that angle is here is theta, and that angle is theta here, and it can also be shown. And all the angles indicated by the blue asterisk is just going to be equal to 90 degree. Now let us just use the following notation. We write the angle between the x1 prime axis and x1 as x1 prime. We write it like this. Now generally the angle between the xi prime axis and xj as this. Therefore we define the set of numbers lambda ij, or which is the directional cosine, by this equation here. Now for the same diagram, let us just do the directional cosine. For an example, let us take the lambda 1 1. The lambda 1 1 is therefore this the angle between x1 and x2 is just theta. Therefore that is just going to be a cosine of theta. But the lambda 1 2 is the angle between this and the lambda 2, the x2, this angle here is the cosine of 90 degree minus theta. And the lambda 2 1 is this angle here that will be 90 plus theta, and the lambda 2 2 is this angle here, which is nothing else but the cosine of theta. All right, so this is what you are going to have in two dimensions. Suppose that this was. So this is what you are going to have in two dimension, but in three dimension, this is what you are going to have as far as three dimension is concerned. Right, now in terms of the summation, the xi prime is just given by this way, the I can be 1, 2, 3, because we are talking about the x and y and z, or x1, x2, and x3. Right, now inverse transformation is just given by this equation, and also note where is the prime in terms of the inverse transformation. And in terms of the summation, this is what you are going to have, and I just want you to note the exchange of I and j for the inverse transformation. Therefore, lambda I is what we call the directional cosine, as I've said, of the x prime I axis relative to x j axis. Now, it is always convenient to arrange the directional cosine into a square array matrix, called a matrix, and the bolded lambda is symbol is what you call the totality of the individual elements. Now, it can be given by this square a matrix, and this is the transformation matrix or a rotational matrix. Right, for simplicity, let us just do the following example. A point P is represented by this, it's represented by this, and where you are given these x1, x2, and x3. In another coordinate system, the same point is represented by these rotated coordinates, where x2 has been rotated towards x3, x2 has been rotated towards x3 by an angle theta. Find the rotational matrix and determine the coordinates transformation coordinates. So in that case, we just have to start with getting the directional cosine. For an example, the lambda 1, 1, because this is rotated along the x1 axis, therefore the angle between x1 and x1 is just 0, and the cosine of 0 is nothing else but the cosine of 0 is just what you call 1. Yes, the cosine of 0. Remember, the cos graph is just given by that, where here is 2 pi, and here is pi, and there is pi half. Here is 3 pi halves. Right. So in that case, the cosine of 0 is 1. That's why you are going to have 1. So I'm not going to be doing everything. Let me just take, say, for an example, the 1, 3, the lambda 1, 3, the lambda 1, 3, an angle between x1 prime and the x3 is nothing else but is just 90 degree, and the cosine of 90 degree, as we can see, the cosine of 90 degree is just 0. That's why you are going to have 0 there. Now, for argument's sake, let me just take the last one here. Perhaps maybe this lambda 3, 3, the lambda 3, 3, the angle between lambda the x prime 3 and x3 is just 30 degrees, therefore that will just be the cosine of 30. So as a result, with all this and from our definition of a matrix, therefore we can be able to find the totality of this individual the totality of a matrix is just given by that. Now, based on the fact that we know the totality of a matrix or the directional cosine, therefore we can be able to determine what is the coordinate of a transformations. Now, in that case, because we know what is the x1 and x2 and x3. Now, in that case, if you plug the values, because you know this from there, and then you know what is x1, x1 is 2, and then you know what is lambda 2 from there, so for you can just plug the values, and this is what you are going to have. And what is very important is also to notice that the rotation operator preserve the length of the position vector. So this is just the same. So therefore, the length doesn't change by the length of the position doesn't change by rotating the Cartesian coordinate. Right, now let us also dive into the examples of the derivatives. For an example, the velocity and acceleration. In that case, I am just going to define, and then you also remember that from your previous classes that whenever you have the position, when the position is determined by r vector, r vector. Now if you want to get the velocity, velocity vector is always the time derivative of the position, sorry, time derivative of the position, and is just denoted by r dot. And similarly with the acceleration is nothing else but the first derivative of the velocity in terms of and this can also be the second order of the time derivative of the position, and it is denoted by r double dot. Right, now in rectangular coordinate, the expression of the position, v, velocity and acceleration are given by the following. The r is just given by this, and this is very interesting because I just want to show you that the r vector, note that when it is bolded, it means it's when the symbol is bolded, it means it's a vector. So the r vector, because here I'm writing, I'm just going to write r vector is just x in x roof plus y in y roof plus z in z roof. So this is just the same as whenever I see x, I write x1. Therefore, but the unit vector, I denoted it is as e1. Now, for argument's sake, I will just write that plus x2 and then e2, that is a unit vector, plus x3 in e3. Those are the unit vectors. So here I did not show the unit vectors, but I just assume that you'll be able to see that those are unit vectors. And of course, this can just be written in terms of the x1, x2, x3, because this means this is x1 in e1 or in x roof, and this is x2 in e2 direction, this is x3 in e3 direction. Right, so that's the notation that I would prefer to use, this one here. All right, yes, so you just have to be very careful of that. Now in terms of the velocity, as we have said, is the first derivative of the position with respect to time, and acceleration is the second order derivative of position, while is the first order of the derivative of the velocity. Right, now you just consider a particle moving along the ST, moving along the xt from p1 to p2, and then the st in the time interval t2 minus t1 is just given by dt. Now it just moved from p1 to p2. Now in that case, the unit vectors er and e theta, which are orthogonal, change from e1 to e2, and the e theta from e theta 1 to e theta 2. Now in that case, the change in er is er2 minus er1, which is nothing else but the change in dER, as the similarly with the unit vector e theta. Now if that is the case, therefore we can be able to tell that the dER, because the dER suspend an angle d theta with sides unit vector er, therefore we are able to write this equation here. Therefore, because that dER is in the direction of theta, it is in the direction of theta. However, the dE theta suspend the angle d phi with the unit vector a theta. Therefore, that is what you are going to have for that. Now, and of course, I want you to see that negative sign represent that the dE theta is in the opposite direction of the ER. So that's what I want you to see. Now, from the previous slide, this is what we have. Now, if I want you to take the time derivative of this, the time derivative of the dER, and then is equals to d theta in theta. This is a unit vector. This is that vector. Now, if you take the dt and you take the dt there, so this is nothing else but it's just going to be the unit vector the er. That is just going to be the ER. I'm sorry, let me just stop showing this. That is just going to be the ER dot the time derivative, which is just equals to theta dot, and in what you call the the e theta direction, and this is the unit vector. Now I'm not just going to show it there. So that's what you are going to have, and similarly with the other one. Now we know the position vector. Is nothing else but the position vector is r, which is nothing else but the magnitude of r, and then er. So this is actually the unit vector in er. Why this is the case? This is the case because I know that the unit vector is nothing else, it's just the r vector divided by the magnitude of r. Now if you rearrange that equation, you are going to find the r vector is just the magnitude of r, is nothing else but it's just r, and then the unit vector r. So that equation here is just the same as this equation here, but this, the e r roof, is just the r hat. So it's just the same. So in that case, because we know what is r, r is just given by that. Now if you want to take the time derivative of that, the time derivative of r vector is just going to be dt, and then r er. So I'm not going to write that that head, but I just assume that you can see that this is a unit vector. Now in that case, you take the time derivative of r, you use the product rule, you leave that, and then you take the, you leave r, and then you take the time derivative of r. So that's what you are going to have for the velocity. Now but we know what is er. Er is given by that. Now if you substitute it there, this is what you are going to have. So the velocity is resolved into the radial and the angular or the transverse components. Now a second derivative will of course yield the acceleration. The acceleration, we are going to take the time derivative of this, and then we apply the product rule. Now in that case, this is what you are going to, when you apply the product rule for that. Now the acceleration is also resolved in the radial and the angular components. The expression for the ds, ds squared and v squared, and the velocity vector in three most coordinate system, for an example rectangular and spherical and cylindrical, are given by that. Now I always want you to remember this, and remember this because this is what I'm going to be using in the next coming example. But before we can do that, let me just remind you, in terms of the spherical coordinate, we have r, theta, and phi. I just want to remind how r varies and how theta varies and how phi varies. Yes, that's what I always want to show you. Now in that case, let me just start with r. You see r, you remember r is actually always the r will always be moving from zero to a certain radius r. Now the theta will always be moving from zero to pi, but the phi, what will be the phi? Phi will always be moving from zero to 360. So now phi will always be moving from 0 to 2 pi. So that's what I want you to always remember in terms of the spherical coordinates. Right. Good. Now let us do the following example. Find the components of the acceleration vector a in the cylindrical coordinates. So now we have to know what is the velocity in the cylindrical coordinates, as I told you that I want you to remember. Now we take the time derivative of that. Now if we do that, now we are just going to take the time derivative of velocity in cylindrical coordinates, which is this. And now if you apply the product rule, this is what you are going to have. Now what is also very important here is to just see that we have the unit vectors, and because we don't know what are the unit vectors, now how can we get the unit vectors and the time derivative of this unit vectors in cylindrical coordinates? So that's what I want us to do. Now we need to find the time derivative of unit vectors. Now the unit vectors are just given by this, and I hope you can be able to derive this unit vectors. Now for an example, let me just do it quick for you and also remind you of the fact that in cylindrical coordinates we have x in cylindrical coordinate, we have x is equals to r cosine of phi, and then we have y is equals to r sine of phi, and then we have z is just equal to z. So now the r vector is nothing else but it's just r cos phi, and then r sine phi and z. So now if we want to define the er vector is nothing else but it is just going to be the dr vector with respect to r, and that is nothing else but it's just going to be what you call the, we differentiate this with respect to r, that is just going to be the cosine of phi, and then the sine of phi, and then zero here because this doesn't depend on r. So that is the e vector, but the e vector is not the unit vector er. Now how do you get the unit vector? The unit vector, you remember, the unit vector will always be the unit vector in er is nothing else but it's just the er vector divided by the magnitude of er. Now the er vector is this, is cos phi sine of phi, and I will only do this one of the unit vector in r, and then you just do the same with the other ones, and divided them by the magnitude. The magnitude of this vector is nothing else but is cos squared phi plus sine squared phi plus zero squared. Now in that case you can just see that this is just going to give us one. Now as a result, the unit vector in r is nothing else but it's just cos phi sine phi and zero, and this is what you are seeing in there, right? So this is what you are seeing in there. Now you apply the same, but for an example, if you do it for argument's sake, if you do it for the e phi, therefore here you are just going to check the vector that, and then there you will have this, and then this is not going to be the answer. This is not going to be the answer. You just have to do it, and then here you are just going to have that, and then here you are just going to have that, and then here you are just going to have that, and of course this is the answer that you are going to get, is not going to be that, but the answer that you are going to have in that case is just going to be this, and I leave it to you to do, and you also do the same with the unit vector in easy. Now from that we can take the time derivative, and of course the time derivative, for an example, let me also do it for only this one, the er in for this one. Now suppose that the er, and I'm only going to do it for this one, and then you will also do it for the rest. Now the unit vector in er, I'm not going to show the unit vector there, it's just the, say you've got the cosine of theta of t. Now if you have to take the time derivative there, the time derivative of the er, the time derivative of er, where you have the er is just given by this cos phi, and then the sine of phi, and then zero. Now I want us to take this. Now if you have, say, a certain function f, say you have a certain function f, and that function is just given as the cosine of phi is a function of t. Now if you have to take the df dt, so you are just going to use the chain rule. Now first of all, this is minus sine phi. I'm not going to write that. But now you also have to take the time derivative of this theta, theta prime. Therefore, you are just going to have this. But for argument's sake, so that we can understand this, we normally write this in terms of minus. We start with phi and then the sine of that, so that it can be understood that this is the time derivative of that. So this is the best way of writing this. Good. So that was the first one, which is this one here. You do the same with the rest. You just do the same with the rest. As you can see, this is what you are going to have in terms of the time derivatives of the unit vectors. Why are we doing this? Because we have seen that the acceleration there, we have the time derivatives of this. Now, the unit vectors also. Therefore, we just have to plug all these results back in there. Now, if you do that, this is what you are going to have as your acceleration. Good. This is in cylindrical coordinates. Right, now let us also dive into the angular velocity. The line passing through the center of the circle and perpendicular to the instantaneous direction of motion is called instantaneous acceleration of rotation. As the particles move in the circular path, the rate of change of the angular position is called the angular velocity, which is just given by that. Now the V is nothing else but is just R omega. This is what you know from the previous classes. Now, in that case, the direction of the linear velocity is perpendicular to R and in the plane of the circle. But we know what is R. What is R from this diagram here? What is R in this diagram? The R is just given by R sine theta. Now, if we plug R in that equation, this is what we are going to have. And of course, this can be written in terms of the vector notation as V is omega cross R. So that's what you are going to have. Now, in terms of the gradient operator, let me just summarize everything in a very short time. Now, the gradient operator, we call it a del, and that del is actually defined in terms of dx in x roof plus dy in y roof plus dz in z roof. Now, this del is a gradient, because it's a gradient in different direction. Now, it's actually an operator. It can x on a certain function phi. Now, if that is the case, if it x on a scalar function phi, therefore we end up with the following. That is just going to be dx in x roof, which is just a gradient, plus d phi dy in y roof plus d phi in dz in z roof. As we can see, while this is a scalar, but the gradient of that scalar is actually a vector. This is a vector because you have the unit vectors pointing in different directions. Right, that's what I wanted you to know. And of course, we can also do the gradient, the del can also be dotted with a certain vector A. And when it is being dotted with that, in fact, all in all, I can just write this del is a vector. Therefore, this, when it is written like this, this is what we call the divergence of A. For an example, in electrodynamics, we normally talk about the divergence of the electric field E. The divergence of electric field E, which is nothing else but the rho over epsilon naught. Now, it can also be written in terms of a cross product of A, which now, when it is written in terms of the cross product, is what we call the curl. For an example, you know, the curl of the magnetic field in the electrodynamics. So that's what I wanted to really summarize for you in terms of the gradient. Now, this gradient is just given by this equation here. The gradient is always a vector. It's always a vector, while it can actually operate on a scalar. But the answer for the gradient of the scalar is always a vector. Right, now this is what I've just discussed, and this is just the curl of A. Right, now the successive operation of the Kleinian operator produces the what you call the Laplacian, and the Laplacian is nothing else but is the del square. Is the del square. Now the Laplacian of a certain function psi, or for an example in quantum mechanics, the Laplacian of a wave function. This is what we normally say. So this is what you are going to have in terms of the Laplacian, the second order differential with respect to x and y and as well as z. Now let us also talk about the integration of vectors, which is actually the last part of this lecture video. The vector resulting from the volume integral of a vector A in different axis is just what you call this, is just given by this. Now this is the volume integral of vector A dv, and is actually the triple integral, and is just denoted by this. The dv is actually denoting the triple integral, because it's the volume integral. Dv is just the is just denoting the triple integral. The triple integral, for an example in spherical coordinates, where you have r move from 0 to r, and theta moves from 0 to pi, and phi move from 0 to 2 pi. d theta d phi. So this is what you are going to have when you have some other terms there. So for the spherical coordinates, right? Now in terms of the integral over the surface of the projection of the vector A, therefore the surface integral is just given by A dot 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 dA. Remember, when the alphabet is bolded, it means that it's a vector. Now in that case, we know what is a dA. dA is actually the vector perpendicular to the surface, and the magnitude of that vector is nothing else but it's just that area. Right, now the components of dA are the projection of the elements of an area. dA is just given by this equation here, and this is what you are going to have in terms of the surface integral, because you know what is the dA. dA is just given by that. Now it can just be written in terms of this. Now the last part of this is the line integral. Now the line integral of a vector is just given by this A dot ds, where the ds is nothing else but is just the elements of length along the given path. Now in that case, it is often useful to relate the certain surface integral to either volume integrals, which is the Gauss theorem, or the line integral or Stokes theorem. Now in that case, you have the surface integral of A dot dA can be written in terms of the volume integral of the divergence of that vector in terms of the volume integral, and that is what we call the divergence theorem of the Gauss theorem. Now this is the line integral. It can be written in terms of the surface, and this is what we call the divergence theorem, or the Stokes theorem, and it is actually given like this. So this is what I want you to know before we can actually dive into the other chapters. So that's the basics of the vectors or matrices that I want you to know. So I would like to pause here, and that is your tutorial one problems, and this tutorial problem must be submitted for marks. So I would like to pause here and goodbye.